I'd like you to take your Bible, if you will, and turn with me to Matthew chapter 3. Matthew chapter 3. Today the message is entitled, The King Arrives. The King Arrives. Matthew chapter 3, we'll begin our reading at verse 1. If you don't have a Bible, just raise your hand. We have a few extras in the back. We'll bring one to you. All right, let's follow along and consider this very important portion of Scripture. Matthew chapter 3, we'll begin our reading at verse 1. Are you ready for the Scripture? All right. Now in those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea, saying, Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is the one referred to by Isaiah the prophet when he said, The voice of one crying in the wilderness, Make ready the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. Verse 4. Now John himself had a garment of camel's hair and a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then Jerusalem was going out to him in all Judea and all the district around the Jordan. And they were being baptized by him in the Jordan River as they confessed their sins. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Therefore bring fruit, or therefore bear fruit in keeping with repentance. And do not suppose that you can say to yourselves, We have Abraham for our father. For I say to you that from these stones God is able to raise up children to Abraham. Verse 10. The axe is already laid at the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. As for me, I baptize you with water for repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I, and I am not fit to remove his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clear his threshing floor, and he will gather his wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Then Jesus arrived from Galilee at the Jordan, coming to John to be baptized by him. But John tried to prevent him, saying, I have need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me? But Jesus answering said to him, Permit it at this time, for in this way it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he permitted him. And after being baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending as a dove and lighting on him. And behold, a voice out of the heavens said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. This is God's infallible, inspired, and inerrant word. May we hear it to our salvation and sanctification today. Let us pray. Lord, we believe that your word is fully inspired, that it is our bread, our meat, our milk, our honey, but it is also like a hammer to break away the hard places in our hearts. And we ask that today you would grant us by your Spirit's power not only a right understanding of your word, but a proper hearing of it. Help us to receive the word today. You said that it would be implanted in us. It would save our souls. Remove, Lord, the barriers and the obstacles that exist in our thoughts and in our hearts today. Make our hearts like a roadway for repentance and for your presence. We pray this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Chapter 3 marks the beginning of the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. Today, as we peel through and work through this passage, it's going to feel more like a Bible study than a sermon. However, I need to labor much on the front end to give you some context so that these words might come to life for you. Now, make a note in your Bible that this chapter, chapter 3, actually marks a turning point in salvation history. Between Matthew chapter 2 and chapter 3, there is a 30-year gap. As we come to this text, this chapter, if there was one key phrase that sets before us the main theme of the chapter, it would be the first three words that is found in verse 13. The first three words. Then Jesus arrived. It's the main theme of the chapter right there. Then Jesus came. The King arrives. He's on the scene. Mark, in his gospel, says that the emergence of John the Baptist is actually the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, there are two branches of thought in this chapter that helps us to approach it, and we can divide this chapter into these two parts. The first part, we find the herald's proclamation. The herald's proclamation. And the king's herald was John the Baptizer, preparing the way for the arrival of the king. That's shown to us in verses 1 through 12. In verses 13 through 17, we find the heaven's affirmation. The heaven's affirmation. And if you just let your eyes kind of survey verses 13 through 17, what you'll find there is a Trinitarian event that was both visual and verbal. We see the Father given an affirmation from heaven. We see the Holy Spirit being represented in the dove falling upon the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son. It was a Trinitarian event affirming the ministry of the Messiah. Now, again, the best way to understand this text is for us to understand the context of chapter 3. And by context, I'm saying what's around it. We need to understand the immediate context, and then we need to understand the larger context. And if we do, these words will come to life for us. And so what is the context of chapter 3? Well, we go back to chapter 1, and we discovered, of course, in our study so far, that our promised king was a descendant of Abraham, and he was of the royal line of David in chapter 1. And therefore, Jesus has the rightful claim as the king, not only of the Jews, but the king of the world. In chapter 1, verse 21, we discover that the king's name is Jesus. That's his name. His name means Jehovah saves. If you want a kind of a simplified modern way of thinking about it, Jesus' name means that he is a rescuer. For the Bible says that he will rescue his people. He will save his people from their sins. Chapter 1, verse 21. We also discovered that his name is Emmanuel, which means God with us. And the good news is that Jesus is not just God with us, but the good news is that God will be in us and for us as we repent and believe. And so as we consider the context, we discover much about the Lord Jesus Christ. We come to chapter 2, and Matthew stops long enough in the early childhood of Jesus to remind us of his life and his circumstances and the events of his life. They were foretold in Scripture. We are not in the dark about the life of Christ. We discovered last week that from his earliest days, Jesus was displaced. Jesus was distressed. Jesus came through difficulties, and he even was despised from his earliest days. Why? Well, yes, he has come to identify with us, and we need to understand that Jesus knows he cares. But listen, knowing that Jesus knows and knowing that Jesus cares does not save you. Matthew wants us to understand that in order to have a relationship with this king, it starts with repentance. It starts with repentance. As we come to chapter 3 now, Matthew steps across the stage of history, 30 years, and he tells us that as Jesus begins his ministry, there is a message that we need to hear. There is a ministry that we need to understand. The question is, what will his ministry be like? When this king arrives, what will he do? Matthew tells us, Matthew gives us a powerful picture here in chapter 3, that when our king comes, he will exercise a twofold ministry. That ministry will have a purging effect. When he comes, he will be discriminating in his presence and in his power. And he gives us this picture in verse 11 and verse 12. I hope you noticed it. Verse 11, John said, "As for me, I baptize you with water for repentance. He who is coming after me is mightier than I, and I'm not fit to remove his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire." Verse 12, his winnowing fork is in his hand. He will thoroughly clear his threshing floor. He will gather his wheat into barns. Pay attention now. And he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. John points out to us, John the Baptizer, that Jesus will come on the scene and his arrival on the scene will be different than John's. For John came baptizing with water. Water cannot transform you. Water cannot change you. There are so many people who come to church and get baptized and all they do is get wet. But Jesus, when Jesus comes into a life, he baptizes with an entirely different baptism. He baptizes with the Holy Spirit and fire. Those two words should be taken together. It simply describes to us the purifying, purging, refining power of the Holy Spirit. The first fire is a refining fire. The second fire is a destroying fire. It says, when Jesus comes, the ministry of the king will be like a purging fire. When he comes, those who repent and believe will be cleansed. They will be transformed. They'll be renewed. And the Holy Spirit will be a part of that work. That's the first fire. The second fire will be a destroying fire. It'll consume the empty, useless husk. In that first fire, there will be a gathering of his wheat. In that second fire, there will be a burning away of the chaff. It's a powerful picture of the ministry of the king. That's the immediate context. Let me give you a larger context of Matthew 3. Are y'all still with me? There's a larger context in which these words are found, and a part of what we see happening in Matthew 3 is a fulfillment of the burden that was given to the prophet Malachi. For nearly 400 years, the people of Israel had not heard from a prophet. The arrival of John the Baptist on the scene signaled that that long period of silence was over. The last words that the nation heard before the heavens closed its windows and went silent is found in the last book of the Old Testament. Would you turn back a couple of pages and turn with me to Malachi? Let's begin in Malachi chapter 3. This is what the Lord said to his people almost 4 centuries before Matthew 3. Malachi chapter 3, beginning in verse 1. This is what God said to them. Behold, I am going to send my messenger, and he will clear the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. And the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of his coming? And who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like a fuller's soap. Verse 3. He will sit as a smelter and a purifier of silver. He will purify the sons of Levi and refine them like gold and silver, so that they may present to the Lord offerings in righteousness. Flip over one page to Malachi chapter 4, which was read in your hearing. As we try to consider what Matthew 3 is saying, or Malachi 3 is saying, the message of the Old Testament was simple. He's coming. He's coming. He's coming. He's coming. The question is, what will he do when he comes? We're told here that he comes to sift. He comes to refine. He comes to separate. He comes to transform. Now in Malachi chapter 4, pick it up with me. Malachi 4 verse 1, behold, the day is coming, burning like a furnace. And all the arrogant and every evildoer will be like what? You remember that word in Malachi, in Matthew 3? You remember the picture in Matthew 3, verse 11? Every evildoer will be chaff, and the day that is coming will set them ablaze, says the Lord of hosts, so that it will leave them neither root nor branch. Do you remember that picture in Matthew 3? That the axe is already laid at the root of the trees. How do we know that the day has come, the day of the Lord, the day that Malachi spoke of? How do we know? Malachi 4, verse 5. Malachi 4, verse 5. Behold, I am going to send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and terrible day of the Lord. Are y'all following me? Now, as we come back to Matthew chapter 3, the silence is broken. John comes as the last of the Old Testament prophets, as the forerunner of the king. He comes in the spirit of Elijah. How do we know this? How can we be sure of this? How can we know that John is the forerunner? How do we know that he is the one that Malachi spoke of? How do we know? Thank you for asking. We know because Jesus tells us. If you now turn with me to Matthew chapter 11, turn to the right, come to Matthew chapter 11. This is our authority for saying that John the Baptist is the one that Malachi spoke of. Here's our authority, Matthew 11, verse 7. Follow with me now. Matthew 11, verse 7, as these men were going away, Jesus began to speak to the crowds about who? About John. What did you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken by the wind? But what did you go out to see? A man dressed in soft clothing? Those who wear soft clothing are in king's palaces. But what did you go out to see? So he's repeating the question because he wants them to think. He wants them to think about what has taken place. He says, a prophet, verse 9, yes, I tell you, and one who is more than a prophet. This is the one about whom it is written, behold, I send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way before you. Truly, I say to you, among those born of women, there has not arisen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Yet, the one who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. Verse 12. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, which means that it's forcibly entered by false people. And violent men, that is, lost men, take it by force. That is to say, they seek to seize the kingdom for themselves. Verse 13, for all of the prophets and the law prophesied until John. Here it is, verse 14. And if you are willing to accept it, John himself is Elijah who was to come. You all see it? Verse 15. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Is that clear? I love the clarity of God's word. Is that clear? No? Come on, somebody, let me know that you're paying attention. I'll start the sermon all over again, perhaps I think. And so Jesus tells us that John is the forerunner. So the immediate and the larger context is this. John's ministry signaled the beginning of the gospel of Jesus. It marked the arrival of the king. It was the fulfillment of Old Testament scripture, and it broke a period of silence where they had no fresh revelation from God for 400 years. Now, I know I'm laboring from behind the text, just an extra note, one more extra note. What was happening in that 400 years? What was taking place? During that time, according to Christian history and even some secular history, we discover that Jewish tradition actually hardened. The rulers of the Jews had set up synagogues all around the nation, and the reason they set up these synagogues all around the nation is because they believed that Israel was sent into exile because she ignored or broke God's law, and they were right. Israel did break the law. But they were taught that the thing to do, the most important thing to do, was actually to go learn the law again. And in these synagogues that were set up, the law was taught for a long time. But then someone came to the scene, a group of men called the Pharisees. When they came to the scene, they did something. They took the kernel of God's law and they began to add traditions onto it. They began to add teachings onto it. They were empty teachings. They were like husk around the kernel of the law. And because of their traditions, the people were led astray. Jesus even confronted them about that in Matthew 15. So during that period of about 400 years, the nation went down because of errant teaching. Errant teaching. The nation was in trouble. Jesus said they were dispirited and distressed like sheep without a shepherd. This is what happens when false teaching comes into a church. It destroys people's lives. It distracts and discourages and distresses people because it's not what God intended. And this is why here at the Church of South Mountain, we have a commitment to sound theology. We have a commitment to staying by the book. Because if we stay by the book, rightly interpreted and rightly applied, we'll be healthy. God will bless us. God will grow us. God will strengthen us. But when we get away from the word, we're in trouble. The emergence of John was like a voice. It was like a voice preparing the way for his son. And now we come to the text. Now, I'm not going to work my way through this entire chapter, so relax. Today, I want to show you three truths about the forerunner of the king that will help us to understand the message of Jesus and the ministry of Jesus. I want to give you these three points, but then we will only cover the first. Does that set you at ease? All right, here are the three points, and we see these three points in the text. In verses 1 through 4, we discover something about his messenger. In verses 5 through 10, we discover something about the messenger's challenge. And then in verses 11 and 12, we discover something about the herald's promise. Now, today, we're going to look only at the first. And we're going to consider what the Bible says about the messenger. Let's pray. Lord, hearing requires a great deal of focus. Lord, we need the capacity to listen with our hearts and not just with our heads. So help us as we drill down deep into the truth that it would make its inroads into our hearts. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Matthew chapter 3, verse 1, follow along with me. We begin in verse 1. Now, in those days, John the Baptist came. Stop right there. Matthew doesn't give us much of a bio on John, does he? The reason that he doesn't is because he is assuming that everybody knows about John. Everyone knows about John the Baptist. Now, in case you don't know about John the Baptist, let me give you just a short abridgment of his life. John the Baptist is not John the Apostle. He is not the John who wrote 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, the Gospel of John, and the Book of Revelation. That's John the Apostle. John the Baptist is not John the Apostle. The John spoken of here in verse 1, John the Baptist, was the cousin of Jesus. His father was a priest named Zacharias, and his mother's name was Elizabeth, a relative of Mary. Now, although John may have been expected to follow the priestly line of his father, the educated priestly line of his father, nevertheless, he was called as a prophet. From his inception in the womb of his mother Elizabeth, John had special written all over his life. His conception came later in life for his mother, who was barren, and his parents were advanced in age, according to Luke 1. The trajectory of his life and his ministry was announced by an angel, for his parents were told that his birth would cause many to rejoice. For the Bible says in Luke 1, 13 and following, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord, and he will drink no wine or liquor, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit while yet in his mother's womb. John had special written all over his life. They were told that Jesus or that John would go as a forerunner before Jesus in the spirit and in the power of Elijah. He would turn the hearts of the fathers back to the children and the disobedient to the attitude of the righteous, and he would make ready a people prepared for the Lord, Luke 1:17. John had special written all over his life. From the very time of his birth to the time of his ministry to the time when he came preaching, crying out with this urgent tone, John was not an echo. He was a voice. What he heard from God, he spoke. He was so anointed. He was so powerful that hundreds came out and responded to his preaching, confessing their sins, being baptized. He was so effective that they gave him a nickname, John the Baptizer. He had special written all over his life. In the first four verses, we're told four signs about John that signal to us that Jesus is coming, that Jesus is about to arrive on the scene. We're told about his location. We're told about his message. We're told about his purpose. We're told about his dress. Why did John come to this area preaching as he did, dressed as he was? Was this a marketing ploy? Was he trying to just get converts? Why? Why did John come in this way? Oh, listen, dear friends. The inauguration of John's ministry was, according to Matthew, to fulfill Scripture. It was to fulfill Scripture. It was a sign that the King has really come. Now, I'd like you to notice in the first verse that John, first of all, comes preaching in the right place. Verse 1, in those days, John the Baptist came. He came preaching. The word preaching there is a strong word. We won't spend time on it today, but it's a strong word, which means that he was heralding. He wasn't discussing things. He wasn't having a talk. He wasn't trying to peel back layers of meaning on words, you know, and breaking down Hebrew. When John came preaching. He came heralding. He came crying out. There was an urgency to his tone. Preaching strong. Preaching God's word. Preaching what he heard from God. He came preaching, and he comes where? In the wilderness of Judea. Now, specifically, he was somewhere around the fording of the Jordan River in the Judean desert. For verse 5 tells us that all were going out to be baptized by him in the Jordan River. Now, why is that significant to us? That's significant to us because this is the very place, this fording of the Jordan River, this was the place that the nation first crossed to come into the promised land. And we'll come back to that later. That's a significant detail. So he comes preaching in the right place. Secondly, he comes preaching the right message. Notice his message. Verse 2, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. What is his message? It is a twofold, two-part message. Listen to it carefully. It is a message of what the king requires in order to be rightly related to him. That's the first part. It is a message of where the kingdom consummates. It is a message of where the kingdom comes to fruition. Where is that? In the king himself. What is required of those who will come into the kingdom of Christ, what's required is repentance. How do we know that we have arrived or that we're in the kingdom of heaven or kingdom of God? Same, same. It's because the kingdom is consummated in the Son. For when Jesus came in Matthew chapter 4, he was preaching this same message. And in Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, from that time, Jesus began to preach and say, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. You hear that? Not that it was near, but it's at hand in me. Now, ladies and gentlemen, what does it mean to repent? To repent simply means to change one's mind. But it's much more than just changing your opinion. You know, we have a lot of that going on today, a lot of changing of opinions, you know, presidential candidates from one week to another, folks just changing their opinions. Listen, repentance is not just changing your opinion of something. It's much more than that. It's cognitive. It's mental. It starts in your mind, but it doesn't end there. It touches your emotions. And it touches your will. Repentance involves a change of mind where you have a totally different perspective about four things. You have a totally different perspective about God, about Christ, about self, and about sin. And if your mind hasn't changed about God and His holiness, Christ and His mercy and grace, yourself, and sin, you've never repented in your life. Repentance involves this repudiation of the old life, but it's also a redirection of one's life. Now, listen carefully here. I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time here because I think John gives us some details about forgiveness or about repentance that we'll see later. But note this down. That repentance is not simply saying, I've done wrong. But repentance says, I'm wrong. Not just what I've done, but who I am. I'm all wrong. I'm all twisted up because of sin. You see, repentance is the foundation of becoming a Christian. Repentance is a change in your self-estimation. Watchman Nee, that Chinese theologian, said, even after a person has a right estimate of himself, he is not saved. Repentance only corrects one's own self-assessment. It does not. It does prepare him to receive the salvation of Christ. Man must repent before he can receive mercy. Then he goes on to say this, and I quote, while repentance is the negative, faith is the positive. Repentance causes me to lose myself. Faith enables me to gain Christ. Repentance is the impression. Faith is the expression. Repentance causes me to face self. Faith causes me to face Christ. Both are needed. Martin Lloyd-Jones, that preacher, one of my mentors, preaching in London long ago, said repentance means recognizing that you are a guilty, vile sinner in the presence of God. That you deserve wrath and punishment from God. That you are hell-bound. And that you begin to realize that this thing called sin is in you. And that you long to be rid of it. You long to turn your back on it in every shape and every form. You renounce the world, whatever it costs. The world in its outlook, the world in its practices. You deny yourself, you take up the cross, you go after Christ. Your nearest and dearest may call you a fool. And you may have to suffer financially, but it makes no difference. That's repentance, end quote. That's repentance. John comes preaching. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Let's go on further. John not only comes to the right place, comes preaching the right message, but notice he comes fulfilling the right purpose. Verse 3. For this is the one referred to by Isaiah the prophet when he said, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make ready the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. What's John's purpose? The forerunner's purpose, write this down somewhere in your Bible, is to remove obstacles. He's to remove obstacles that kept people from surrendering to the king. That same voice comes in our ears today, reminding us, telling us that we must take out of the way those obstacles that hinder us and obstruct the very rule of Christ in our lives. Matthew says John's ministry was actually a fulfillment of the words that are found in Isaiah the prophet, Isaiah chapter 40. Turn there with me real quick. Isaiah chapter 40, 40, Isaiah 40, verse 3. Come with me here for a second. Let me show you something very important. Remember, we're going to stop early, so don't panic now. Just stay with me. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3. Now, at the beginning of the text, the prophet says, comfort, comfort, O my people. Isaiah 40, verse 1 says, your God, speak kindly to Jerusalem. Call out to her that her warfare has ended, that her iniquity has been removed, that she has received of the Lord's hand double for all her sins. And then here it is, verse 3. Now, watch it. A voice is calling. And really, the term is crying out. Crying out, clear the way for the Lord in the wilderness. Make smooth in the desert a highway for our God. Let every valley be lifted up, every mountain be made and hill be made low. And let the rough ground become a plain and the rugged terrain a broad valley. Then, verse 5, the glory of the Lord will be revealed. And all flesh will see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. What is the picture? The picture is of a king traveling. But before that king travels, a forerunner goes before him to prepare his way. You understand that in the ancient days, travel was not easy. You know, you couldn't just get on a plane and go somewhere or get on a train and go somewhere in the ancient days. Actually, it was very, very difficult to travel in the ancient day. There was an Eastern proverb that said, there are three states of misery, sickness, fasting, and travel. In other words, you want to be miserable, travel. The roads were nothing more in that day and time than tracks made by mules and carts. And so for this reason, before a king went anywhere, what would happen is that his way was prepared. They would go before him and they would build a highway. And in the ancient day, the roads, the highways were called the king's highways. You see, a clearing was needed in the wilderness. A smooth surface needed to be created in the bumpy desert. A smooth highway, if you will. Valleys would need to be lifted up. Mountains made low. Rough ground made smooth. Rugged terrain like a broad valley. Then the king would travel and come into an area. You see the picture? Now the picture that is presented to us in Isaiah and echoed by John is a picture that tells us about the king's arrival, and that before the king comes to a soul, some road work needs to happen. And that road work is in our hearts. Now come up close and listen as we come to the conclusion here. Our nature, our hearts are like a wilderness. Sin has made it that way. It has no clear path. Our way, our hearts do not, because of sin. Our hearts, our souls are like deserts. Dry, barren, parched. No water. Spurgeon, at this point, cried out in his study, "Oh Lord, I would welcome you if you would come to me. There's a need for thy royal presence, and I will prepare the way for you by repenting." Does your heart cry that same way? Lord, I need your presence. My soul is dry, parched. I need your life. I need your direction. I need your power in me. The question is, how do we prepare our hearts? Answer, repentance. The obstacles must be removed. Now, if we go to the imagery, the question is, what are the valleys? What are the valleys? The valleys are the very deep places and low places of sin in our hearts. The valleys are the crooked places that have deviated from God's word. They're in your life and they're in mine. There are places where it, in your life and mine, it just doesn't line up with God's word. God tells us in his word, lift it up to my standard. What are the mountains? These are the high places of pride. These are the attitudes of arrogance. They need to be brought low. They need to be humbled. And if you don't do it, God will do it. What are the rough ground and the rugged terrain? What are they? Well, the rough ground and the rugged terrain describes the places in our lives where there's a lack of love, a lack of forgiveness. It makes relationships difficult, makes relationships bumpy, makes how we get along with others difficult. John is telling us to prepare your heart. Now, as the prophet's words are not intended to tell us that we must change this before the glory of Christ is seen. The prophet's words are not even implying that we have the power to change it. The prophet's words, Isaiah's words, John's words, are meant to tell us there are crooked places. There are mountains. There are rough terrain and there are rough places. But it is through such things that God makes a way for himself through by his means of grace, by his gospel, by his spirit. He will come through those places into our lives. And when he does, making a way for himself, then it'll bring forth fruit in keeping with repentance. You cannot change this by yourself. I cannot change this. But God brings his salvation through these kinds of places. And he saves by his own power and by his own grace. This is what the messenger of the king proclaims. He comes to the right place with the right message, with the right purpose, and finally he comes in the right dress. Verse 4, he comes wearing a camel's hair tunic, leather belt, eating wild locusts and honey. What's the purpose of this? According to 2 Kings chapter 1, this is what Elijah wore. This is what Elijah wore. You see, and like Elijah, who was the first of the prophets and became a symbolic representative of their ministry, the figure whom God had promised, the herald who was to come, would be like Elijah. And so he comes to the right place with the right message, the right purpose, and the right dress. You got it? Oh, I think you're still trying to track with me. What does all this mean? His messenger comes to the right place. He has the right. I'm trying to make sure you're tracking with me. Number four, he has the right purpose. Finally, he has the right. Got right dress. What does all this mean? Here's the conclusion. What God is doing with Israel in Matthew chapter 3 is he is taking Israel back in history in order to show her the future. God takes them back to the first prophet, symbolized by Elijah, back to the place of entry into the land, the Jordan River, and John's appearance, John's message, John's location, all proclaim that this is the day of the Lord. In other words, this is the day of new beginnings. This is the day of new beginnings. And John is proclaiming, Emmanuel is coming, you must prepare for him. It's the day of new beginnings. Now, how do we apply this to ourselves? Well, just as God was taking Israel back to understand her history so that she could understand her future, God takes us back. But he doesn't take us back to Israel's history. Do you know where he takes us back to? He takes us further back. He takes us back to a garden. He takes us back to Adam's history. And he shows us that it was through one man's disobedience that sin entered the world, and death through sin, and death spread to all men because all sinned. That sin has made our lives like a wilderness, like a desert. It has filled our lives with thorns and thistles. Why is it so difficult in life? Why is it so difficult in family? Why is it so difficult in marriage? It's because of a man's disobedience to God that sin came into the world. And through one man that sin came and that death spread to all men. But it is also through another man. And through his obedience, that life comes. And Paul said it this way, for as through one man's disobedience, the many were made sinners, even through the obedience of the one, many are made righteous. This is the good news that John comes to proclaim. That you can begin again in Jesus. That you can have a new heart. You can have a new start. You can have a new life. You can have a new beginning in Jesus Christ. For Jesus comes to change the wilderness of my nature and to transform it into a garden of the Lord. And so I have questions for you to close. Here are the questions of application. We won't linger on them long, but the first one is this. Are you ready for a new beginning? Are you ready? You said, Pastor, I don't feel like I'm ready. Why are you saying that? Are you saying you're not ready because you feel like you have to change something first? Did I not just show you that you cannot do it? God never intended for you to do it, but that God will make a way through those hills and mountains and rugged places in your life. And when he does, by his glorious means of grace, that you will bring forth fruit in keeping with repentance. No one is ready, but we all need it. Are you ready? Do you want it? I guess would be the more important question. Number two, are you prepared to commit yourself to the king? You see, this is the problem of the Pharisees. Not only did they misinterpret the law, they were unwilling to commit themselves to a suffering servant, to the Messiah, to the king. Listen, you can't have the kingdom of God without committing yourself to Jesus. I meet so many professing Christians who say, you know, oh, I love God with all my heart, and I'm committed to Christ. But they're not committed to the church. They're not committed to the gospel. They're not committed to love. Listen, if you're going to have the kingdom and be in the kingdom, it means being committed to Jesus, which means that his word is the final authority in your life, above your spouse's word, above your children's word, above the world's word. Here's the last question. Have you experienced the refining, purifying presence of the Holy Spirit that Jesus gives? Where he's burned out those evil motives. He's refined your life. The husk that used to be there, he has burned it away by his presence. You can't even get away with sin anymore. Because the Spirit of God won't let you. The moment your attitude is wrong, he convicts you. The moment your thoughts go astray, he convicts you. The moment you want to get lazy and give up, he picks you up. The moment you're seeking for direction, he directs you to the Word. That purifying, that sanctifying, that pruning presence of the Spirit of God. Have you experienced him? This is what happens when we repent of our sin and believe in Christ. We're given the Holy Spirit, and he transforms us. And if any man be in Christ, he is a... All things are passing away. Behold, all things have become new. Let's pray. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed as you bow your head. I want you to think of the low places and the high places that God has already perhaps worked through in some of your lives. He's busted through those things and brought salvation to you, and yet you still see rugged terrain. You still see a lack of love. And it's causing you, even at this moment, to repent. And if it's not, you can question whether you have even received the Spirit of God. But if you have, the Lord shows you by his power and his word that there's places that we need to be lifted up and brought down, that need to come into harmony with his word. Perhaps it's your giving, perhaps it's your serving, perhaps it's your soul winning, perhaps it's your love of your children or your spouse or brother or sister. Christians are repenters. That's what we do the rest of our lives. And so would you today say, oh God, you have once again found me wanting. Lord, would you forgive me? I confess my sins to you. Lord, would you restore me? Would you help me to come in line with your word, not just in my thoughts and desires, but with my actions. Would you pray, Lord, I don't want to be a Pharisee, simply looking like I'm repenting, but not really repenting inside. And perhaps you're here today and for the very first time, God has shown you that the way to himself starts with the road of repentance. Would you confess to God, Lord, I am wrong. I am all wrong. My heart is all wrong, and I need you to give me a new heart. I want you to give me a new start. I want to commit myself to Jesus. Come and make our hearts your home, O Lord. For thy name's sake. Amen.